The stories of people who broke through. Stories of the men and women who accomplished the impossible against the odds.
Martin Luther King. In the 1950s and 60s, he led black Americans on their long march toward freedom and equality.
I have a dream. When all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., a man of contradictions, a man of peace. He fought a war against hatred, a man of nonviolence. His life was haunted by clubs and fists and rifles. Success and comfort were within his grasp, but he chose to walk a harder road. Hi, I'm Bill Bixby, and today we'll see the story of a man who fought against the odds for his dream.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
The American Constitution promised equality for all. But in the 1920s, when Martin Luther King was born, there were two sets of laws, one for white people, another for blacks. It was a time of violence, a time of white resistance to Negro demands for equality. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream was to bring America out of its nightmare of racial hatred.
All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper.
America was called the land of opportunity. But in the Depression, when Martin Luther King was growing up, there was almost no opportunity, especially for blacks. For them, the American dream was a nightmare that began over 200 years before in Africa. King's ancestors, along with many thousands of others, were captured and crammed into slave ships. Many died. Others were humiliated at the hands of the slave traders. In the New World, conditions were no better. The Africans were thrown into a land with a strange language and even stranger customs, a land where even the greatest leaders owned slaves.
I love my slaves.
So do I.
In this new land, the white slave owners lived in grand houses while the blacks lived in shacks. Cotton was king. Cheap labor was needed to work the fields. The slaves did the work, and the white man reaped the harvest. But it wasn't going to last forever. The Civil War put an end to slavery. In 1863, President Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, and the slaves were free.
Ain't nothing wrong about having your mind on freedom. Ain't nothing wrong about having your mind on freedom. Ain't nothing wrong about having your mind on freedom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
But all too soon, the sounds of celebration turned into sounds of terror. The Ku Klux Klan and other racist groups used terror to deny the black man his rights. The burning cross, the Klan's symbol of hate, spread across the country. And in its shadow, no black man was safe. Laws were passed to force blacks and whites to remain separate. Jim Crow laws, and they cheated Negroes of their rights. Even their right to vote.
You can only vote if your grandfather did.
My grandfather was a slave. He couldn't vote.
Case closed.
On paper, the black man was free, but he was still forced to live as a slave. And for those who protested, the answer was always the same. Hoping to escape poverty and racial hatred, many blacks moved to the North. Harlem in New York City became a center for black culture. There were writers like Langston Hughes, actors like Paul Robeson, but most of all, there was music. Louis Armstrong. Lena Horne. Cab Calloway. They played jazz, and both the music and the performers became famous. Bill Bojangles Robinson, the great Duke Ellington. Despite the many accomplishments of blacks, white Americans continued to paint an insulting picture of the Negro.
I've been down so long. Not worry me no more.
And with the humiliation came the hatred. In 1926, the Ku Klux Klan marched on Washington, D.C. Just 3 years later, Martin Luther King Jr. was born in Atlanta, Georgia. Although for the most part, young Martin had a happy childhood, he learned early about racial prejudice and hatred. He saw his father, a respected Baptist minister, treated as an inferior.
We don't serve colored at the front of the store.
Young Martin decided he was going to fight racism, but he wasn't sure how. From his father, he learned the teachings of Jesus. Return your enemy's hatred with love. From the philosopher Thoreau, he learned about civil disobedience. When faced with an unjust law, refuse to comply. And from the great Indian leader, Mahatma Gandhi, he learned the power of nonviolence. In the 1940s, Gandhi used mass civil disobedience to lead his country to independence. King was inspired. These would also be his methods. He became a minister, married Coretta Scott, and moved to Montgomery, Alabama. In the South, black people were forced to sit in the back of the bus and give up their seats if a white person wanted to ride. One day, Rosa Parks, a black woman, refused to give up her seat to a white person. She was arrested. But the black people of Montgomery had had enough. It was time for Martin Luther King to lead.
Are you ready for the question? All in favor, let it be known by standing on your feet.
That was the day that we started a bus protest which literally electrified the nation. And that was the day when we decided that we were not going to take segregated buses any longer. And from that day on, that boycott was more than 99.9% effective.
This is a nonviolent protest. We are depending on moral and spiritual forces using the method of passive resistance.
I, for one, under God, will die before I'll yield one inch to that kind of a movement.
The forces of hate fought hard, bombing, burning, killing. But they couldn't break the back of the boycott. The blacks stayed off the buses. They carpooled. They stuck together. They won.
This morning, the long-awaited mandate from the United States Supreme Court concerning bus segregation came to Montgomery. This mandate expresses in terms that are crystal clear that segregation in public transportation is both legally and sociologically invalid.
With a victory in Montgomery, Martin Luther King Jr. catapulted into national prominence. Black people discovered they had the power to change laws that were unfair. But Jim Crow would not die without a fight.
walking, Georgia. Keep on a talking, Georgia. Marching at the freedom
land. One of the great glories of American democracy is that we have the right to protest far right.
Following King's victory in Montgomery, blacks demonstrated against segregation in schools, in restaurants, in beaches and buses. And they found violent opposition. Some died in the fight. Many more were arrested. Including Dr. King himself. But the movement continued to grow. A march in Albany, Georgia, led by Dr. King, captured the attention of President Kennedy in Washington.
Let me say that I find it wholly inexplicable why the city council of Albany will not sit down with the citizens of Albany, maybe Negroes, and attempt to secure to them in a peaceful way their rights. The United States government is involved in sitting down at Geneva with the Soviet Union. I can't understand why the government of Albany, City Council of Albany, cannot do the same for American citizens.
But the white people of Albany, like most other Americans in the early 60s, had other things to think about. But King would not let America forget. He decided to challenge Birmingham, Alabama, the most segregated city in the country. This meant King would come face to face with the city's police chief, Bull Connor.
You can never whip these birds if you don't keep you and them separate. You've got to keep the white and the black separate.
I will not rest until we are able to make this kind of witness in this city so that the power structure downtown will have to say, we can't stop this movement, and the only way to deal with it is to give these people what we owe them and what their God-given rights and their constitutional rights demand.
Fighting for freedom meant you had to be willing to go to jail for your beliefs. By committing acts of passive resistance, by marching, by protesting, by getting thrown in jail for it, blacks could show the world how difficult it was to obtain justice. In Birmingham in the spring of 1963, the jails were filled by these people fighting for their rights. Their struggle made headlines across the country, and it was televised around the world. From behind bars in the Birmingham jail, King wrote,
"We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. We had no alternative except to prepare for direct action, whereby we would present our bare bodies as a means of laying our case before the conscience of the local and the national community."
Television showed Bull Connor's dogs and fire hoses to an outraged nation.
We will not hate you, and yet we cannot in our good conscience obey your evil laws. But we will wear you down by our capacity to suffer. In winning the victory, we will not only win our freedom, we will so appeal to your heart and your conscience that we will win you in the process.
Freedom! Freedom! Freedom!
Martin Luther King Jr. had taken the greatest risk of his life and won. Against segregated Birmingham, against Bull Connor, against the odds. 3 months later, more than 200,000 people came to Washington, D.C. for the largest civil rights demonstration ever held. The marchers were black and white, young and old, Gentile and Jew. And on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, Martin Luther King spoke to the entire nation. But in America, there were still many who did not share King's dream. Once again, the angry and violent had their day. Civil rights workers were brutally murdered. President Kennedy was assassinated. He died before his landmark civil rights bill could be passed. For Martin Luther King, the struggle never let up, and neither did the criticism.
I think when Martin Luther King has used us as much as he wants to, then he'll move out.
He was still an enemy to the White South, but to the rest of the world, he was a hero. In 1965, he was awarded the highest honor the world can give in its search for peace.
I accept the Nobel Prize for Peace at a moment when 22 million Negroes of the United States are engaged in a creative battle to end the long night of racial injustice.
The world acclaimed Dr. King, but in the United States, in towns like Selma, Alabama, black people were still segregated, still kept from registering to vote. In January 1965, Dr. King led Selma's black citizens on a march to the state capital of Montgomery to present their demands to Governor George Wallace.
Any preconceived march along the public highways of this state is not conducive to orderly flow of traffic and commerce within and through the state of Alabama.
I say to you this afternoon that I would rather die on the highways of Alabama than make a butchery of my conscience.
Yes, sir.
If we march, don't panic and remember that we must remain true to nonviolence. I'm asking everybody in the line. If you can't be nonviolent, don't get in it.
Right.
If you can't accept blows without retaliating, don't get in the line. If you can accept it out of your commitment to nonviolence, you will somehow do something for this nation that may well save it.
The right to walk the highway. We have the right to walk to Montgomery if our feet can get us there.
The greatness of this period was that we armed ourselves with dignity
and self-respect. Greatness of this period was that we straighten our backs up. And a man can't ride your back unless it's bent.
Last Sunday, more than 8,000 of us started on a mighty walk from Selma, Alabama. They told us we wouldn't get here. There were those who said that we would get here only over their dead bodies.
Well, talk.
Yes. All the world today knows that we are here and we are standing before the forces of power in the state of Alabama saying we ain't going to let nobody turn us around.
Selma was the turning point in the struggle to attain voting rights. 5 months after the March on Montgomery, the Voting Rights Act, the most important civil rights legislation in a century, was signed into law by President Lyndon Johnson.
This Civil Rights Act is a challenge to all of us to go to work in our communities and our states, in our homes and in our hearts, to eliminate the last vestiges of injustice in our beloved country.
While the civil rights struggle went on in the South, frustration and rage built up in the northern ghettos. In the summer of 1965, they exploded. Riots broke out all across the North. King brought his nonviolent movement to Chicago.
So we come bearing a message. We come bearing a message that Chicago can change. And we are going to change it nonviolently. We are going singing in our hearts. Ain't going to let nobody turn me around.
Martin Luther King was met by the ugliness and rage of Chicago's white neighborhoods. Frustrated blacks began to question the path of nonviolence. King was accused of being old-fashioned, irrelevant. Angry new voices were challenging him in the black movement.
The rebellions that we see are merely dress rehearsals for the revolution that's to come. We better get ourselves some guns and prepare ourselves.
I don't see the answer to our problem in riots. So my slogan is not burn, baby, burn. My slogan is build, baby, build. Organize, baby, organize.
And King continued to organize a struggle for freedom. In March 1968, he came to Memphis, Tennessee. It was there he spoke for the last time.
We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now. Because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
The next day, Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. was shot and killed. The dreamer was dead. But his dream lives on.
Hatred exists everywhere, and prejudice, and violence. They happen on every page of history. Martin Luther King made his country face up to its hatreds, and he gave people a dream of something better, something worthy of a nation dedicated to freedom and equality. Oh, the hatred still exists, but so does the dream. I'm Bill Bixby. Thank you for joining me on Against the Odds.
Every summer going up in flames, every day killing up people in Vietnam like we're killing. We can't continue this way as a nation and survive. And you can believe it if you want to. And some of us are going to have to take the burden of saving the soul of America.